maybe I can start with a question. You mentioned that, you know, how AI will affect the labor market is very much about choices and how we design it. So in terms of policy, you know, at a very superficial level, I would say for many people in Europe, the perception is, okay, we in Europe, we have started regulating AI even before understanding it, where it seems that the US approach is like, okay, let it go and see where it takes us. I think most Europeans have sort of an uneasy feeling about this and say, okay, we're missing the opportunities, whereas the US, you know, is getting successful in this and so on. Is this, would you subscribe to that view, or is it too simple, or?
Well, I mean, I think there's merit to that view, but there's a huge number of trade-offs, right? So the US is always like, you know, no hands, no helmet, down the hill as fast as possible. And that leads us to some great innovations and some terrible mistakes. So, you know, in research I've done with David Doran, who's sitting here, on looking at the way the U.S., the trade shock that so much affected U.S. labor markets, you know, our view was just, you know, free markets, cheap prices, let it rip, embrace it, and it had traumatic and long-standing effects on U.S. labor markets, on U.S. politics, right? Arguably, it's kind of one of the forces that's reshaping the U.S. trajectory right now. And so, you know, I think a more thoughtful approach might be say, well, how do we mitigate the risks while taking advantage of the benefits, right? And I do think it is dangerous to regulate something that we don't really know how to use well. On the other hand, you got to say, well, what are the risks that we're facing? Something the U.S. does not do well, and that many Europeans countries do much better, Denmark being the leading example, but Germany being an example too, is they provide safety nets and retraining, right, to enable people to make successful transitions, right? So Anders Humlum at Chicago Booth from Denmark has done amazing work showing how effective retraining can be. So we didn't have any such safety nets. I have other ideas on this, but I think we should, but let me say, there's kind of three things that we should be doing. One is looking for major risks and trying to mitigate those. A second is, of course, providing social insurance of different forms, because we know this is going to be disruptive, right? Even if it's going to be 5% better on average, right? For some people, it's going to be 105% better, and for some people, it's going to be 100% worse, and maybe no one is going to experience 5% better, right? So we need to be prepared for transitions. We need to be prepared to enable change. And the third thing we should be doing is really trying to steer productive uses of AI, right? And this is something I was hinting at in this notion of collaboration, right? There's a lot of activities, especially, you know, like health and education, where they're mostly provided by the public sector, and there's huge opportunity there, right, to improve the way we deliver services, but also to improve the quality of work, right, like those nurse practitioners. And that's an opportunity that requires not just regulating, but investing. And I think there's more of that we could do.
Thank you, David. So we have a lot of questions here about how, you know, people could or should adjust to AI, and I'd like to pick up some of those. So one, for instance, let me read it. Today, many people say AI will replace many jobs, even some managers. In your view, what leadership qualities or capabilities will make managers indispensable and uniquely valuable in an AI-driven organization? People are afraid here.
Yeah. Good question. So, first of all, there's no question that some of these technologies will displace work, right? If you're a language translator, there will be fewer people who do language translation or medical transcription or people who do advertising copywriting or a lot of creative, you know, illustrative and narrative things that, you know, I think have been unjustly, you know, used without compensation by AI, but they will displace that type of work. And it certainly will, not all of it, but some of it. So you have to ask, well, what is the unique human capability in that realm, right? What do people need to be able to do? Well, look, we live in a world that has too much information, right? When I was in college, and people of my generation, right, information was scarce, right? If you want information, you go to the library, and you would track it down, you put it in a notebook, you would cite it, right? And you hand in your paper with information, and that was a very important activity, right? Now, information runs like, you know, filthy water, out of your computer all the time, right? There's too much information, and it's of varying quality. So an important thing that people need to do is be able, in a very noisy, complex, misleading environment, to make analytically sound decisions, to make plans, convince others, and lead them, right? There's a lot of evidence that leadership is a skill. A lot of evidence that good planning and decision making is a skill. So I think managing the resources in this overwhelming environment, you know, and that applies in management, that applies in medicine, that applies in law, that applies in construction, that applies in almost any difficult work that people do. So I think there's tons of opportunity for young people who build those portfolio of skills to thrive. However, I will say, before this lecture, I met with LMU honor students, and they were asking me about AI, so I asked them about AI, and I said, you know, are you optimistic? And I would say only one of about 20 people in the room was optimistic. Another one said, I'm just uncertain, I have no idea. And the other 18 just thought it was not good news. So that's pretty disheartening, right? Even if let's say they're wrong, it is good news. If they believe it's bad news, that itself is bad news, right? I think it's really the uncertainty about how jobs will change and what skills will remain valuable or become more valuable is weighing greatly on people. I think I'm more optimistic than many, but I don't think it's going to be smooth. It's not going to be Pareto improving, right? We should be simultaneously optimistic about what's possible, but also pessimistic in recognizing the risks and the dislocation.
Let me pick a related question. So here someone asks, what advice would you give to current graduate students who think about the implications of AI on their own research careers? Should we specialize more or try to become well-read generalists? What are the most valuable skills as future economists in your view?
Okay, good. Actually, it's funny. Students also asked me this question. And I thought, like, how many of you here are practicing economists? How many of you think AI has been helpful to you? How many of you have felt that AI is threatening to your work? Okay, right, so we're gonna say approximately no one. There may be five people who didn't wanna raise their hand. But most of us, right, think this has never been a better time, right? And not just because we can research about what AI does to people, right? but because it's given us new tools, right? What are we good at? We're good at asking questions, we hope, and analyzing them well. What we're not good at is doing immense amounts of calculation, taking unstructured data and turning it into research data, right, in modeling really complex things with unassisted. So for people in research, this feels like a great moment, right? And so it collaborates with us, right? It is not automating us. And I think in many cases, people are much more pessimistic about what it will do to others and not as worried about themselves directly. Like if you look at surveys of what people believe will be automated, everyone believes that the two hardest things to automate are nursing and their job, whatever it is they do, that cannot be automated. So I'm not concerned about the future of economics. I think it's opened new questions, but also given us immense tools that have been useful for the way we analyze data, the way we produce data, the statistics we use, right? So it's a great opportunity.
Okay, so I think there's at least one economist who is a bit worried. Do you see economist jobs being threatened by AI in the future? But if I understand you correctly, you're saying not really.
Not research economists. It's possible that if you are doing a kind of something that's much more kind of running a model and cranking in, you know, inputs and watching the outputs, that possibly would be. So I don't want to say none, but in the research realm, it feels like a golden era.
So here's one maybe inappropriate question. Does Professor Autor invest in AI stocks? Let me rephrase that. Let me rephrase that. Is it a bubble or, anything to say about what's going on or?
Okay. So, I would say two things. One, I know less about finance than your average index fund investor. Like, I all my money is index funds, so I probably own AI stocks, but I couldn't tell you because I have no confidence in my ability to predict. The only good thing I can say about that is economic theory tells me that I shouldn't be able to predict, right? That if it was predictable, it would all be priced in. So I don't know. But if it is a bubble, I feel like that's the problem of the AI companies. Like, good, that's capitalism for you. Oh, well, right? So, you know, we'll survive it. I wouldn't put all, I'm too risk averse to put all my money in that. But I think, you know, there was also a dot-com bubble. Right, and it produced some spectacular failures, right? Like pets.com that was worth $2 billion until it was worth zero. Or like two businesses competing to deliver chocolate bars to your house, right? How are they ever gonna make money on that? We are in that era of AI, and there's tons and tons of bad ideas that are attracting money, and many of them will fail, but that's okay. That's the process of discovery.
Do you think overdependence on AI models or LLM will make people dumber? And what does it mean for inequality?
If everyone's dumber, that'll be very equalizing. I do actually think there's now a bunch of evidence that people who, you know, that just like that autopilot, people who rely very heavily on tools that automate, they do lose facility. Like human expertise, it's great, has a short shelf life. You need to keep it in practice. Like, you know, pilots, professional pilots have to spend multiple days per year in a flight simulator, even though they fly for a living, right? Just to practice. And so I do think, and this goes to the work I was talking about by Tanya Buccino, for example, how do you use tools to enable people to deploy their expertise more effectively and learn it more efficiently? That's the incredible design question that we face. But it's quite possible for just the opposite to happen. And this is especially concerning in education. You know, my older daughter's partner is a public school teacher, and he teaches honors English. And he says, you know, and the kids that he has, never in their life would they ever think of cheating on anything. But now now that they have AI, they don't sort of think of that as cheating. They just have a chatbot do a writing assignment. Well, you know, that undermines their learning, but at the same time, they think, well, if I don't, everybody else is doing it, I'm going to be punished for not doing it, right? So it's actually a very difficult situation for people not to default to an unproductive thing. So learning how to use AI is like, if you're not writing or doing your work with a chatbot window open, you're missing an opportunity, right? Because there's all kinds of ways it can be useful to you to say, like, explain this to me, help me brainstorm this idea, you know, draw a picture of this, etc. But if you just use it to attempt to do your work for you, in the long run, that's not going to be very productive. I think the evidence, by the way, of like the from the recent paper by Chatterjee and Deming and others of the data from OpenAI says most people are using it for asking rather than for doing. They're asking it for explanation and advice rather than just do this task. But I do think there is really a danger there.
Do you think the recent trend of the labor demand turning from juniors to seniors, if it happens, especially in tech jobs, is a direct result from the introduction of generative AI tools? If yes, how will future generations gain the expertise to grow into this high expertise group that will ultimately profit from AI?
Good. Okay, so I'm actually quite skeptical of the evidence that this is even happening. There's a very influential paper, you know, done carefully and thoughtfully that sort of suggests that young people are not being hired into AI-exposed jobs. But it turns out those jobs are very cyclical, and the Federal Reserve raised interest rate in the United States from 0% to about 5% over the course of a few months, and that's when that hiring started to slow down. And in fact, it slowed down among seniors and juniors. It's just that juniors are always the leading edge of this. So, you know, there's other work from Denmark that also shows down a kind of slowdown in hiring in the young, but it's not more pronounced in firms that are using AI. So I don't think the evidence right now is very strongly supportive of that hypothesis. However, I don't want to dismiss the concern, right? I think it is a possibility, right? Many, many jobs that we do, that where we develop expertise, right? Learning is kind of a byproduct of the production process, right? Whether that's in medicine, that's in law, in consulting, right? You have these junior consultants and all they do is like work 100 hours a week with spreadsheets and whatever. And if seniors decide they don't need those tools, they don't need those juniors to do that, that learning that happened incidentally will not happen. So I think it's a problem. I think it's also a problem that we will solve, right? Because there's an enormous incentive to solve this problem. You cannot have a labor market where firms only hire experienced workers, right? In the long run, someone has to hire inexperienced workers to make them experienced. So we have systems for this, right? We have apprenticeship systems. We have educational programs. We have, you know, you pay for to get there. So I think it's a solvable problem. It's a legitimate problem. The evidence for it is not very strong, but I don't want to dismiss it because it makes sense.
Great. Now, I have tons of questions here, but we're running out of time, so I think we should conclude here. I would like to thank you all for being here. I would like to thank John for his fabulous laudation, and of course you, David, for a fantastic lecture and inspiring discussion. Thank you very much. You are all...
Thank you all very much.
So this lecture is over, but our conversation, of course, is not. So there will be a reception next to the Spearman Sperrträger, 50 meters from here, to which you're all invited. So I'll see you there. Thanks again, David, and have a nice evening. Thank you.